Dear students, after having seen the in the introduction to maxillofacial trauma of how to assess the trauma patient, now let us go into the management of fractures of individual regions or individual bones. Like you know, the most prominent component of the facial skeleton is the mandible, and hence we will deal with mandible fractures now. Okay, the most common of the fractures. So what is very peculiar about mandibular fractures? In that case, you take the maxilla, zygomatic complex, nasoorbital etmoidal fractures. All those fractures occur in concomitantly with the fractures of other regions, I mean, of the facial skeleton. So isolated fractures in, except this mandible, in other areas are very rare. So say for example, so that's why they call it as a fracture of the middle third of the facial skeleton, or you have the fracture of the Lefort 3, which is the craniofacial disjunction. All those things, they are associated with the other bones, but whereas mandibular fractures, it can occur in isolation. So why the occurrence in isolation is very important to us? Because such patients, as soon as they have sustained mandibular fracture, they will note prominent tooth mobility in the region. Once the patient notes prominent tooth mobility, he will resort to a general dental practitioner first. Provided the fracture is in isolation, the patient is conscious. As soon as the patient or his attender recognizes there is a tooth mobility, then the patient will be resorting to you. That is why in your year 5, we have the preclinical exercises which aims at imparting you some skill to manage uncomplicated mandibular fractures through various wiring techniques. We have learned all those techniques, isn't it? So you start with the Gilmer's direct wiring, arch bar wiring, eyelet wiring, and Essig's wiring, and all those wiring techniques are intended to equip a general dental practitioner to treat mandibular fractures, especially when they occur in isolation or in case of simple fractures. Okay, so with this pre-context, let us move into the various aspects of mandibular fractures. It is a quite lengthy topic, but don't worry, you can relate it very easily, and then it will be very interesting for you to grasp and understand the concepts. Okay, so mandible is a bone, that something which you can very easily imagine, and then you can understand the treatment concepts very easily, though it is going to be a lengthy topic. Okay, fine. So the fracture of the mandible, being the movable bone of the facial skeleton, is more frequent than any other fracture of the facial skeleton because of its prominent position also. So the fracture occurrence is more common, and the relevant part is that it is most common in dental practice. Okay, so you do expect to get patients to a clinic with mandibular fractures. Okay, and very rarely the fracture of mandible can occur as a complication of tooth extraction also, especially when the dentist is overzealous or when he is giving undue force in an already softened bone because of various pathological conditions. You can cause an iatrogenic or pathological fracture. So be careful when you are exerting force during removal of the molars, especially the molars. Okay, fine. So the fractures are broadly divided into two groups: fractures without significant loss of hard and soft tissues, whereas fractures with significant loss of hard and soft tissues, that denotes the extensivity of the fracture. So those fractures which are well within the scope of the treatment of general dental practitioner are those which without significant loss of hard and soft tissues. So when there is an associated significant loss of hard or soft tissues, you mean to say that the trauma is very extensive, the treatment needs hospitalization and other accessory care. So those patients have to be admitted at the hospital, whereas those patients which you will be able to treat will be admitted in the, I mean, you can treat it in the dental clinic as an outpatient procedure. Okay, fine. So why? What are the causative factors for these fractures? Predominantly road traffic accidents, interpersonal violence, falls, sports injuries, and industrial trauma, work-based hazards. All those things can cause trauma. So how would you classify? So you classify a simple, compound, comminuted, and pathological fracture. Okay, so understand one concept. Any fracture in which the line is in communication with the external surrounding is called as a compound fracture. It doesn't matter about whether it is a single fracture or multiple fracture. If the fracture line can communicate with the external environment, then it is called as a compound fracture. In that aspect, do remember, all the fractures involving the denta alveolar segment should be considered as a compound fracture, because the fracture eventually communicates with the oral cavity through the periodontal ligament space, the tooth bearing segment. So you have to know that all the fractures involving the denta alveolar segment of the mandible should be considered as a compound fracture, irrespective of the extensiveness or the nature of involvement. Okay, so don't think that just because there is a single line in the you can find it in the OPG, it's going from a premolar till the from canine till the premolar region, it's a single line. So don't think that it is a simple fracture. It is a compound fracture, which means that contamination from the oral cavity is possible, secondary infection is possible, which indirectly means that you have to cover up with adequate antibiotics. Okay, fine. Comminuted fractures, when there is splintering and then there is the bone is literally broken into many pieces, you call it as comminuted fracture. Pathological fracture, in which the bone strength is already compromised. So the least amount of force which otherwise would not cause a fracture can have a fracture in pathological type. For example, your osteomyelitis can have pathological fractures. CA, in which there is extensive invasion, can cause pathological fracture. Osteoporosis can cause pathological fracture. Osteoradionecrosis can cause pathological fracture. So all these things in which there is a bone is already diseased, and hence a slightest amount of pressure or the disease process itself divides the fragment into two parts. So it is called as a pathological fracture. This fracture by a pathology, it is called as a pathological fracture. So where all it can occur, what all the anatomical regions you know in the mandible, it can occur. So you start from your subchondylar region, coronoid process, angle of the mandible, ramus, body of the mandible, symphysis, parasymphysis, everywhere the fracture can happen. Of course, including the dental alveolar segment, everywhere the fracture can happen. Okay, so accordingly, the treatment plan will vary. So how it can happen? It can be either by direct violence or indirect violence, in which the bone response to the direct violence absorbed by one region of the body, and then the opposite region undergoes fracture. We will see that. So the fracture can be unilateral, bilateral, it can be multiple or comminuted. Self-explanatory. This is regarding the surgical anatomy, which compares the thickness analogous to various objects. Like if skull can be comparable to the thickness of the helmet, then the mandible's thickness is comparable to hockey stick, and then the middle third of the facial skeleton, that is the maxilla, can be the thickness of the middle third of the facial skeleton is comparable to that of the safety matchbox. So it means so thin it is because of pneumatization, isn't it? We have the maxillary sinus and many sinuses you have, and then mandible is, I mean, maxilla is again a very spongy bone. So you will have the thickness is very minimal there. This is actually a protective phenomenon, so that when the face is getting sustaining an injury, much of the force is being absorbed by the matchbox like maxilla, so that the force get dissipated there itself. And then it is preventing the force being dissipated, transferred to the cranial base. Okay, so in that way, in that aspect, it gets It's a protective phenomena. The face, the brain gets protection from the maxilla by absorbing all the forces and then getting fractured there. Okay, fine. And then you have the favorable and unfavorable fractures. The fractures can be either favorable and unfavorable. The concept is very simple. So by muscle action, if the fractured fragments or can be held together in a reduced position, that is in a pre-fractured position, it is called as a favorable fracture. Say for example, here the fracture lines runs from posterior to anterior, and hence because of the muscle pull of the masseter, the ramus tries to move forwards, but it is being stopped by the fracture line, so that the mandible's architecture is being maintained. Such kind of fracture is called as a favorable fracture. Here you have unfavorable fracture, in which see the fracture lines goes from anterior to posterior, whereas the muscle pull cannot hold the fracture. In fact, the fractured fragment, that is the distal fragment, overrides the proximal fragments, hence the fracture is unable to get restored. So this is called as an unfavorable fracture. And the distal fracture, again you are seeing in the other plane, in which the fracture is getting displaced medially because of the muscle pull, the other muscles, medial pterygoid, lateral pterygoid, all those things. Okay, fine. And then when the fractured fragments are kept moving away from each other by the virtue of muscle pull, again it is called as a unfavorable fracture. For you people, when you are starting in your practice, if you want to resort to a treatment, always take favorable fractures for taking up the case and then doing, rather than unfavorable fractures, because most of the time the fractured fragments may not be under the control, especially when you are doing it in the closed reduction. So we have to employ other methods like plating to treat such cases. Okay. So this is a fracture of symphysis, in which fracture of the symphysis will show very minimal displacement, and then most oftenly sometimes it is like you may not require extensive treatment to treat such disorders, like to reduce the fracture, because regular, when the occlusion is not being disturbed, your regular oral hygiene measures with soft food can treat the fracture. Okay, fine. Yeah, this is a parasymphysis fracture, which gets pulled towards the lingual side. And then, yeah, this is something very important. So when there is a fracture of bilateral parasymphysis, we have to be careful regarding the displacement of the fractured fragments. The geniohyoid and genioglossus, which are attached to the genial tubercle, is capable of pulling the fractured fragments back, and then the tongue gets loosened, the tongue falls back very easily, and then it can lead to upper airway respiratory obstruction. So in that case, we have to be very careful in treating the bilateral parasymphysis fractures. When you see these fractures in your clinic, first do a direct wiring to at least stabilize the fractured fragments from being by preventing it from moving distally. Okay, so this is regarding the bilateral parasymphysis fracture. Then the fracture of edentulous mandible occurs at the most weakest point, and you know that in the edentulous state, the alveolar ridge undergoes much resorption, and then because of the muscle pull, the bone becomes much thinner, and then you call something called as the bucket handle fracture, as it's happening here. If the anterior portion of the jaw just becomes like a bucket handle. So this is the fracture in the edentulous mandible. So what are the nerves that can get damaged? Invariably, the inferior alveolar nerve runs through the entire mandible. So any fracture, when it happens, the inferior alveolar nerve will get disturbed, and then the most pathognomonic sign of a mandibular fracture is paresthesia. You get paresthesia, inferior alveolar nerve paresthesia, in case of mandibular fracture. That's something which gives you a clue to the diagnosis. Then direct injury to the ramus area can cause facial nerve injury, and then you can the fracture of the condylar region with the temporal bone fracture can also cause the facial nerve damage, because of the facial nerves close proximity in those areas. and then hemorrhage, yes, it is possible. Bleeding from because of the damage to the inferior vessels is possible, so it, because of the injury, and then direct injury to the near the lower border of the mandible can cause facial vessel injuries, and then it can cause, especially when the facial nerve is damaged, it can cause extensive blood loss. And then in the temporomandibular joint, it is possible because of the entire impact of the force being taken in the intracapsular region, you tend to get some collection of blood inside the joint space, which is called as hemarthrosis. And then when it is more extensive, it can tear the external auditory meatus, and then it can cause the bleeding. So the three stages of clinical examination starts with the immediate assessment and then treatment if threat to life. So any trauma patient, the first step is to preserve the life of the patient. So assess the severity and then treat the immediate threat to life, and then you go with the clinical examination, and then you can go ahead with the local examination of mandibular fractures when you have narrowed down that yes, the fracture is around the facial skeleton. Okay. So in case of mandibular fractures, you do the classical steps of inspection, palpation, palpation, of course percussion and auscultation will not be of much use here. So inspection, you can have the inspectory findings as swelling at the fracture site, you will have bony deformity in the contour of the mandible, and then in palpation you will not have any movement in the temporomandibular joint in case it is being fractured, and then you can palpate for the step deformity in the lower border of mandible, and then of course you can have paresthesia in the lower lip because of the injury to the inferior angular nerve. So in your intraoral examination, you can expect some buccal and sublingual ecchymosis, in which collection of blood inside the mucosa. So this is because when the lingual cortex is being damaged, the blood escapes from the lingual cortex and gets stagnated in the, below the mucous membrane. So there is hemorrhage in the submucosal region, which can be seen as a characteristic reddish or brownish in color. It is called as Coleman's sign. Okay, Coleman's sign. This is one suggestion that clinical clue that you can understand that the mandible lingual cortex is being damaged, especially when you have doubt when there is a symphysis fracture. You can ask the patient to lift his tongue and then look into the floor of the mouth to look for any collection of blood in the submucosal region. And then of course, because the entire mandible is getting fractured, the architecture is being disturbed, so you will have occlusal derangement. Again, disturbance in occlusion is yet another pathognomonic sign of mandibular fracture. Okay, then in palpation, you have to use the bimanual palpation to rule out for the interfragmentary mobility or interfragmentary crepitus. Another thing. Okay, fine. So this is a picture to tell you what is sublingual ecchymosis. This is the red colored discoloration beneath the tongue. You call it a sublingual ecchymosis, and then you can have the step defects, ridge discontinuity and malocclusion as the classical signs of the mandibular fracture. So as we seen in the first photograph, where all it can fracture in dentalveolar, condylar, coronoid, ramus, angle, body, symphysis and parasymphysis. All the regions of the mandible are prone to get fractured. So our discussion would go ahead with how we treat with the individual case. Okay, the dentalveolar fracture is associated with avulsion, that means the popping of the teeth out of the socket, and then subluxation, in which the tooth becomes loosened in the socket, and then you have the fracture of the teeth associated with alveolus. So in condylar fracture, which is the most common of the fracture, and then it can happen as unilateral or bilateral, and then the commonly displaced side is anterior medial side because of the pull of the pterygoid, lateral pterygoid. So the forces resulting in trauma to mandible, it can be either a moving object striking a static individual, that is a stationary individual, or a moving individual striking a static object, or it can be the combination of both. Okay, anywhere the fracture can. So in case of unilateral, you have unilateral TMJ fractures, you have swelling over the TMJ area, you will have hemorrhage from the ear and ecchymosis below the mastoid process, which is called as the Battle sign, which is quite a late sign which develops. So there, though it's a reliable indicator, it cannot be relied upon, because in some cases, in dark complexion individual, Battle signs may not be so much discernible. So you have to use the CT scan to know whether this is happening. Okay, so when there is a fracture of the mastoid process. Okay, so Battle sign is a danger sign in which it can indicate you the base of the skull fracture as well. Okay, so then on palpation, there is tenderness over the condylar head. This is to rule out during the to rule out the condylar. So the movement of condylar head near the external auditory meatus should be palpated, and then when there is loss of movement, you can understand that there is something wrong with the neck of the condyle or in the temporomandibular joint area. And then the height of the ramus is reduced because of the reduced height because of the fracture, and then overriding of the fracture segment. And then you have ipsilateral molar teeth gagging because the height is reduced, and then there is premature contact, and then as a result there is a gagging. And then because of the reduced height, there will be deviation of mouth opening on the affected side. The next fracture is called as parade ground or guardsman fracture, in which the individual usually falls unimpeded without having any protective mechanism. Normally when we fall, we will use our hand to protect ourselves before we reach the ground. This is called as parade ground or guardsman fracture, in which the patient is falling unconsciously, so he is not able to safeguard himself. He will not use his hands to protect himself, and hence the direct impact of the fracture will be borne by the chin region. So you will not have any fracture in the chin region, but you will have some bruised moths there. But when you see in the OPG, you will be surprised to see that both the condyle are fractured. The neck of the condyle are fractured. This is because of the distribution of force, to protect the middle cranial fossa, structures above the middle cranial fossa, the condyle at its weakest point gets fractured by itself. It is called as a subcondylar fracture. So this is the mechanism by which it happens. And then of course, because of the reduced height on both sides, there will be posterior gagging of occlusion because of the premature contact of the molar teeth. And then as a result of which, you will have the anterior open bite. So this is the telescoping of fracture, in which there is overriding of the fractured fragments, because of which there is premature contact, and then you have the deviation of the. So here there is telescoping on both sides, because of both sides there is a condylar fracture, and then there is premature contact, and then you have the anterior open bite. You can see in the picture. Okay, fine. So have a careful look of all these pictures, because you tend to get some ASCII questions from this area, because it gives much scope for asking many questions in the examination. So you will surely expect some from questions from this topic. So so in case of hemarthrosis or effusion, there is no fracture at that area, so there won't be any movement because of the pain the patient has, and then there will be posterior open bite, but the deviation of mandible will be on the opposite side because it is already being pushed to the opposite side. So what are the various radiographic techniques? The classical one is the OPG, which will tell you where the condyle has fractured. And then other than that, when these things are not available, you can have the posterior anterior view, reverse Downs view, and transcranial view. And of course, now every center has the CT scan, and CT scan and OPG have become the gold standard for examining the various mandibular fractures. So the radiographs show you where the fractures are happening. So you can see it from the arrow in the CT scan, in the OPG, and the PA view. So you can see the fractured condyle in the OPG, and then you can see the fractured condyle, and which is medially displaced in the CT scan. So how to treat these condylar fractures? So it has been a controversial topic. Some people believe that conservative treatment is is enough. You need not subject the patient to surgery. Whereas some people believe that no, conservative treatment is not at all successful, so you have to open the area and then do the surgery. The problem is that when you open up the area in front of the ear, you will have the very limited space to operate, and then because of the challenge, the condyle fracture treatment takes longer time than expected, because the fragment get very easily displaced the moment you try to reduce it, because of the pull of the muscles. The pull of the muscles on the condyle are very, very strong. Okay, so there has been a debate of whether to conservatively manage or surgically manage, but anyhow they have given come out with some indications, so which will help you to decide when to do it conservatively, when to do it surgically, that is when to do open up and then do the surgery. So we have absolute and relative indications for open reduction of condylar fractures, which means that you have to do a surgery in which, when the bilateral condylar fractures is in combination, in association with other comminuted L4-3 fractures, so you have to do the surgery. When the condyle is displaced into the middle cranial fossa, you have to literally open it up and then take the displaced condyle out and then reposition it. So you need a surgery. And then when there is an anterior dislocation with the restricted mandibular movement, so unless otherwise you take out the condyle from that area, the mandible is not going to come back. So we have to open up and do the surgery. In case of relative indications in which you have the leeway of managing it with close reduction, that is without doing a surgery, is subcondylar fracture with overriding fragments and anterior open bite, anterior and medial displaced condylar fragment, delayed treatment in a malunited fracture or unilateral or bilateral fracture with loss of posterior teeth, and positioning of the condylar fragment interfering with occlusion. So in case, you have to judiciously use between the open and the closed method. So ultimately, what is the aim of treating the condylar fracture is that the patient has to have a pain-free mouth opening with an interincisal distance of more than 40 millimeter. The jaw movement should be good in all types of excursions, and then you have to have the pre-injury occlusion of the teeth. That is, the occlusion should be restored, and then the temporomandibular joints should be very stable. Of course, we have to have a good facial and jaw symmetry. So these are all the regardless of whatever method you choose, you should be able to achieve these goals when you are treating a condylar fracture. So how to go about it? You have very many approaches. You have preauricular approach, submandibular approach, and retromandibular approach to reach the subcondylar region. So the preauricular approach, you have the incision called as the Alkyd Brimley incision, and intraorally you can have the vestibular incision which can go up till the mandibular subcondylar region. So other approaches are being endoscopic approach and transmesenteric and anteroperative approach to reach the condylar region. Various approaches are being devised. Now, all these have two objectives in common. One objective, you have to reach the condylar area. The next objective, to how much minimally you disturb the facial nerve, because all this manipulation of surgical approaches involve manipulation of the facial nerve. And all the patients will have at least a transient state of facial paralysis. So many approaches are there which help you to avoid these complications, to avoid the facial nerve, at the same time reach the condylar area with a good access. And then various techniques of open reduction and internal fixation are available. You can use the transosseous wiring. Wiring here, in which the fragments are being tied with the wire to prevent the fragment from moving away from each other. You can have the lax screw which can engage inside the bone, and then it can stabilize the fracture. So K wire, and you have the lax screw which can have access from both the retromolar area or from the inferior border of the mandible near the angle, you can engage it. And you have the mini plate osteosynthesis, which you can comfortably place near the fractured fragments, and then you can have the stability of the fractured fragments so that they can heal. And then this is a picture which can tell you regarding the mouth opening before and after the condylar fracture treatment. So this is the disturbance of occlusion here. they have placed the preauricular approach. They have, see, look at the confined area or very limited area where which the surgeons have to operate to reduce the condylar fractures. And then they have used the transmesitic approach also, and then preauricular approach combined. They have reached the mandible, and then they have reduced the. So this is yet another case in which there is a fracture. As you can see in the OPG, there is a fracture in the left side, and then with the transosseous wiring, they have reduced the fracture. And coronoid fracture is very rare, and then it's most probably because of the reflex contraction of the temporalis muscle, and then it may be happening during surgery on large cystic ramus. So when there is extensive destruction of bone tissue, such fracture can happen. Otherwise, coronoid fracture as such is very rare. Ramus fractures are confined to the ramus of the mandible, so it's not so common. It may be single or comminuted. It is associated with swelling, with both extraoral and intraoral swelling, and then there is tenderness over the ramus associated with trismus because of the muscle involved. And angle of the mandible is quite common, so swelling in the external angle, there is obvious step deformity near the angle region, and then there is step deformity in the intraorally also. So there is hematoma on lingual or buccal side associated with paresthesia of lower lip, and then there is tenderness in the angle, and then there is a step deformity. So this is an example of the angle fracture. So they have already done an IMF using islet wiring to do the plating. So in this case, you have the regular third molar incision that we use it during the impaction. And then once the IMF is done, you can have the plating there. So this is another angle fracture, which is being treated with the 3D plating system, which can give you the three-dimensional stability. Okay, this is being done in the angle of the. So you have the fracture of the body of the mandible in which there is signs and symptoms are similar to angle, of course, occlusion deranged, and then there is premature contact of the distal fragment, and then there is intraoral hemorrhage. All these things, which the features of regular fractures of the mandible holds good for this region as well. You have the fracture of the body of the mandible. This is a growing patient. So it's a fracture of the body of the mandible, and then they have placed the plating system here. So the fracture has been, it is into multiple fragments. So accordingly, they have placed the plating here. Okay. So symphysis and parasymphysis fractures are commonly associated with one or both condylar fracture because of the countercoup effect. And it is common in the canine region, and the fracture line is always oblique, which allows overriding of the fragments. This is where you are favorable and unfavorability will come into effect. And then the detachment of genioglossus muscle with loss of tongue control, as I have already discussed in case of bilateral parasymphysis fracture, is of something which you have to have it in mind. And then anesthesia of the skin over the mental region if mental nerve is involved. It is possible, obviously, because your mental nerve exists near the parasymphysis or body. So you can have the mental nerve paresthesia as well. So this is an example of a parasymphysis fracture. It is being treated with plating. So multiple and comminuted fractures result from direct violence, and then when there is always association with severe soft tissue injury. You do have comminution of symphysis, which allows the lateral segment to collapse and presents a severe problem. This will happen in case of high velocity injuries in which the fractures are treated at the hospital setup. You cannot take a risk in treating these patients in your regular clinic setup. Okay. And then how would you diagnose it? So now we have the luxury of OPG and CT scan, and then our college is equipped with CBCT as well. So we have the various advanced techniques, but in case of those advanced techniques are not available, you do have the extraoral projections, which can give you considerable information regarding the fracture. So you have the right and left lateral oblique view, which can give you clue regarding the fracture of the body, angle, ramus and condylar region. You have the PA view, which can give you fracture, which can help you in identifying the fractures near body and the angle. And then you have the reverse Townes projection in case of undisplaced condylar fractures. You have the PA view for the post symphysis and canine, rotated PA view for symphysis and canine region. And you, of course, you have the IOPA to know whether there is teeth in the line of fracture. And you have the occlusal view to show the tooth and the relation of the tooth to the fracture. All these things are possible. And of course, the most desirable one and gold standard one is OPG with CT scan. So after having done all these things, how to go about the treatment of mandibular fractures? Part of the treatment of mandibular fractures have already been taught to you when you have learnt already the wiring techniques. These techniques you can very successfully and confidently employ in your clinic in case the fracture is very simple to manage this. So accordingly, whenever any fracture for that matter, when it comes to management side, remember the three words: reduction, fixation, immobilization. Okay, we will see one by one. These are all the three words: reduction, fixation, and immobilization. When the fractures are by reduction, you mean to say that you are bringing back the fractured fragments in original anatomical continuity. In fixation, you maintain the continuity, and for immobilization, you don't disturb the entire fixed fragment until osseous healing has happened. So these are all the various steps of treating fractures. Any fractures for that matter, it holds good for mandibular fractures as well. So reduction. So restoration of functional alignment of the bone fragments to enable functional rehabilitation. In mandible, occlusion is the key. Occlusion is the key. Remember that occlusion is the key in attaining reduction of the mandibular fracture. So however technically skillful you are, you have treated a mandibular fracture, but at the end you are not able to gain back the occlusion, your treatment goes wasted. Ultimately, it is going to go for any malunion or non-union, which will cause permanent residual deformity. So we have to be very careful in maintaining and achieving the occlusion first and going ahead with the treatment next. Okay. So occlusion is the guide to reduction. So it's better to have the knowledge of patient's occlusion before the fracture, because it can help for perfect reduction. Especially you can see the bare facets in the teeth, especially for to differentiate between a class 3 and a class 2 patient, in which the lower incisors will not have as many as occlusal bare facets in your, the bare facets will not be there in case of a class 3 malocclusion. So you can treat either with open reduction or closed reduction. Closed reduction means you don't see the fracture fragment, but with the help of wiring techniques, you are treating the fracture. Whereas open reduction takes the patient to a operation theater, and then you do the surgery, you place an incision, you see the fracture line visibly, and then you treat the fracture. So this is called as a closed open reduction. So teeth in the fracture line, every general practitioner's question. So how to deal with the teeth in the fracture line? There is a fracture, there is a teeth intervening there. Whether I have to remove it or I have to place it there. So when should remove, when should I not remove? So when there is a teeth in the fracture line, it has got a potential impediment to healing. So all dented fractures are compound that we have seen already. So eventually the tooth has the risk of becoming non-vital. And then when there is an existing pathology in the involved tooth, it may interfere with fracture healing, and then the fracture line may also involve not only erupted teeth but impacted teeth as well. So when will you remove it? When there is a longitudinal split involving the root, that the tooth is split into two, you may have to remove the fracture. You may have to remove the tooth. When there is dislocation or subluxation from the socket, so you can remove the tooth, because it is no longer going to have the splinting action in treating the mandibular fracture. And then when there is a presence of periapical infection, it can disturb the healing, so you can get the teeth extracted. And then infected fracture line, there is already a secondary infection, the tooth should be removed. And then when there is an acute pericoronitis in which there is already inflamed existing signs of inflammation and infection, you can remove the teeth. So when you can wait and watch. So relate functionless truths. It's not actively like it's going to affect the fracture. So you can wait and watch. And advanced caries. So in case of, there is a chance that they may go for amenable for root canal treatment. And advanced periodontal diseases, consultation with periodontist, and then we can decide upon. And then teeth involved in untreated fracture for more than 3 days, you can either remove it. Okay. So if you decide to retain the teeth in the fracture line, so what you have to do, we have to split the tooth if it is mobile, and then all these teeth will require endodontic therapy, that is root canal treatment, and then you have to immediately extract if it is infected, and then if your follow-up shows that the tooth is progressively losing its vitality, then you have to start at the RCT. So this is an example of tooth in the line of fracture. Okay. So immobilization helps in not disturbing the fixed fractured fragments so that healing happens eventually. So this is something to deal with fracture healing, which can happen with the intermediate callus or without intermediate callus formation. Accordingly, you have this compression osteosynthesis versus non-compression osteosynthesis and semi-rigid osteosynthesis, and the if this immobilization is not being done, then you will have the problems of adverse consequence of osseous healing, which is a malunion in which the bone fragments unite in the wrong way, or non-union in which the bone fragments refuse to fuse with each other. Okay. So how long you will be immobilizing? So this is a formula. So basically you have to have 3 weeks for all the fractures. And then if there is a tooth which is retained in the fracture and you want to retain it, then you have to add 1 more week. So if there is a fracture at the symphysis, which will have a very less blood supply, so you can have 1 more week, that is 3 plus 1, 4 weeks. And then when the patient is aged 40 years or over, then you may have 1 or 2 weeks, that is you may have 3 plus 2, 5 weeks. And in case of children and adolescents, they have good growth potential and good healing ability. So they need early immobilization. So you can subtract 1 week. That is, you can release the IMF in 2 weeks itself. So how would you immobilize it? So these are all the methods in which you can. Expect the healing to happen without IMF. IMF is nothing but intramaxillary fixation. We have already learned during our wiring exercises, in which with the wiring technique, you tie the maxilla and the mandible together. I mean, actually the mandible is tied to the maxilla so that movement will not happen and then osseous healing will take place. So you have non-compression small plates, compression plates, mini plates and blast screws in case the patient is not willing to go for IMF. The other techniques are available. In case the patient is going for IMF intramaxillary fixation, you have all the wiring techniques that we have learned. Direct wiring, islet wiring, bonded brackets, arch bar, and the caps plates. And intramaxillary fixation with osteosynthesis, you have transosseous wiring, circumferential wiring, external pin fixation, transfixation with K wires, and bone clamps. Osteosynthesis in which without IMF, in which the patient doesn't want an IMF, he wants early immobilization. I will undergo surgery, but I will not have my mouth tied so that my jaws tied together. For those patients, you have to have this plating system. So the compression plating system, in which when there is an application of when the screw is tightened into the plates, it brings about the movement of fractured fragments towards each other in close proximity, and then you expect some primary healing to happen there. This is an example of compression plating. So when you, as you tighten, the screw moves medially. And then mini plates, it's a semi-rigid form of osteosynthesis. So you have various types to adapt to the regions of facial skeleton. And lag screws involve both the cortices, and then they can bring about the same effect of without use of plate, you can have the fixation. And then when will you opt for these things? Rigid osteosynthesis. So when there is fracture in edentulous part of the mid-body of the mandible, when there is concomitant fractures of the body and condyle where early immobilization is indicated, so you cannot have separate techniques, so you have to have rigid osteosynthesis. Patients in whom IMF is contraindicated, there are very group of patients in which IMF is contraindicated. First is when the patient is not ready to do the IMF, do plating for the patient. So otherwise, asthmatic patients, epileptic patients, this IMF is contraindicated, so we have to use plating in these cases. And then fractures associated with closed head injuries, continuity defects are there, fractures in which there is non-union or malunion has happened. So that means residual deformity is there, and then they have recorrected the residual deformity. In such cases, you have to use the plating, rigid osteosynthesis. Otherwise, you can have the IMF using wiring techniques, you know very well, eyelet wiring, arch bar wiring. The previous one is eyelet wiring, the next one is arch bar wiring, which I don't have to explain you further because you have already done it by yourself. IMF with osteosynthesis. This in case of transosseous wiring, in which there is the direct wiring is done across the fracture line and the holes are drilled on either side of the line, and then the stainless steel wire is passed through the holes and then tightened. In these cases, IMF is necessary because you cannot prevent intrafragmentary mobility. So you have to do the osteosynthesis. You have to do the wiring technique, transosseous wiring technique, coupled with your IMF technique so that the healing becomes better. So this is an example of a CAP splint which is being employed in a growing child. You can see the transosseous wiring in which the wire is being introduced through the mandible, through and through. This is called a circumferential wiring. Wire is passed through the upper bone of the proximal segment and then the lower border in an oblique fracture which controls the distal fragment. So this is yet another form of circumferential wiring. You have an awl. This is called as an awl, which takes the wire through the entire area, to the entire splint, and then you can stabilize the fracture using a gunning splint. So how would you choose these various methods of treating a fracture? Of course, the fracture pattern, skill of the operator is a major determining factor. Resources available. So when in case of a peripheral center, you cannot expect all the hospital to have a plating kit and other things. So you have to utilize the resources. So you can, it can decide the choice of your treatment, and then medical condition of the patient. Of course, it decides whether you have to go for open or closed method, presence of concomitant injuries, local contamination or infection, and associated soft tissue loss will determine how extensive is going to be your treatment. So with this, we have finished the overview of the fracture of the mandible. So you tend to get many short answers, short essay questions and essay questions from especially the OSCE questions from this topic. So better be thorough with this mandibular fractures. Okay, fine. Thank you. All the best.